Good evening. good evening and welcome to our second Varroa mite update of the year. My name is David Chapalias. I'm the Bee Biosecurity Officer for Queensland. We've got a lot of information to cover today. with a number of speakers. We're also recording this session, so if anyone has questions or know people who have missed the update, it should be available online on our YouTube channel very short, next week or in a couple of weeks. So before we begin, I'd like to acknowledge First Nations peoples. I'd like to respectfully acknowledge the traditional owners and custodians of the land on which we meet today, and I pay my respects to their elders past, present, and emerging. I extend that respect to all Aboriginal and Torres Strait Islander peoples who are with us today, meeting here today. So we've got a number of speakers today. We have Philip Meyer, who will be giving us an update on the Queensland situation with Varroa mite and Varroa fly, and we have he's the Varroa mite preparedness response coordinator. We also have Robert Smith, who's the principal operations manager, and he will be talking about biosecurity instruments permits, so applying for permits and compliance. And then I will be talking about our Bee123 survey and how to report survey results, so we can talk about checking Varroa mites. And Joe will give us Joe Martin from the QBA will give us an industry perspective. So and then we'll open up for questions and answers. So with that, I'll hand over to Phil to give us our Queensland update on Varroa mite. Phil. Phil, you're muted. Yep.
Sorry, technology. Well, welcome everybody. I'll be giving you a quick update on some of the key points that that we've been working with over the last couple of months with the response team. So basically, a bit of history. So in response to the detection of Varroa mites, that's Varroa destructor, in New South Wales, Queensland stood up a significant prevention and preparedness effort to support the Queensland honeybee industry, recreational beekeepers, and the plant industries who are reliant on honeybees for pollination activities. DAF has remained actively engaged in the national emergency response arrangements for the Varroa mite incursion that's happening in New South Wales. Initially, DAF stood up its state control centre to support the agency's response activities. However, the department has recently put in place a specialist Varroa preparedness response team to manage the ongoing risk, permitting and compliance associated with the Varroa mite control in Queensland. Well, not control, but response in Queensland. So I guess the most important thing to say is that to date, Queensland remains free of Varroa destructor. We have no Varroa destructor in Queensland, which is great. And hopefully the initiatives we've put in place will ensure that we stay that way. Queensland has previously successfully eradicated incursions of a different species of Varroa mite, which is Varroa jacobsonii, that were detected in the Townsville area in 2016, 19 and 2020. So we've eradicated any known incursion of Varroa mite and we haven't had Varroa destructor identified in Queensland to date. Excuse me. There has been one suspect report of Varroa destructor in Queensland. The mite was detected in a subsample of bees collected from a wild Asian bee honey nest, which was destroyed in a power box outside a residential property in Cardwell. The samples were subsequently sent by DAF's Biosecurity Sciences Laboratory in Brisbane to a Sydney lab for additional genetic testing. Investigations have been undertaken with regard to the Varroa mite detection in the subsample by the Sydney lab, This has included surveillance of both European honeybee and Asian bees in and around Cardwell, where the infestation was found, and at both Sydney and Brisbane labs. All of the evidence collected to date indicates that the mite was a contamination of a subsample by the Sydney lab, and so far there is no confirmed outbreak of Varroa destructor in Asian honeybees in far north Queensland. We're pretty confident we don't have Varroa mite here in Queensland, and we're just awaiting the final reports on the surveillance and diagnostic testing conducted around Cardwell and on the investigation of the Sydney lab by New South Wales DPI. Once these are received, Queensland will be seeking agreement from the National Consultative Committee on Emergency Plant Pests, that's the CCEPP, to close this suspect incident. As I say, we're confident we have no Varroa mite destructor in Queensland. As many of you would know, there is currently a movement control order in place to restrict the movement of bees, beehives, used bee equipment and other Varroa mite carriers into Queensland from New South Wales to mitigate the risks of entry of Varroa mite into the state. Under the movement control order, you cannot move bees, beehives, used bee equipment or bee products, including unprocessed honey, to Queensland without a permit. We're continuing to work with the industry and other jurisdictions to facilitate the movement of Varroa mite carriers into the state where the risk can be mitigated at an appropriate level. A permitting system has been established under the Varroa mite carriers to ensure that they can be permitted to enter into Queensland so that beekeepers can continue to do the work they need to do, which includes moving across the borders. Where appropriate, the conditions for entry are specified in the permit, and there'll be more on permitting in a minute by our esteemed colleague, Robert Smith. Risk assessments are currently being undertaken for movement of queen bees from interstate, and also we're looking at harmonising movement of hives from New South Wales, Victoria, South Australia and Queensland to ensure that we're able to move bees and beehives around the eastern states as required to ensure that the industry can continue to do what it does. We are also undertaking compliance activities, so we have authorised officers who have been undertaking inspections to ensure that we have compliance with permit conditions, which I think is very important, and we'll continue to undertake those surveillance activities in line with compliance to permits ongoing from here on in. And I guess the other issue is that we're asking all Queensland beekeepers to monitor their hives, immediately report any unexpected hive deaths, deformed bees, bees with parasites, poor brood patterns, and dead broods. Vigilance is vitally important, and we need you guys to report any issues that you have with your hives into Bee123. And again, Dave will be giving some more information on that as we go along tonight. From a Barula fly update, currently Barula fly, or bee louse as it's referred to in the legislation, is defined as restricted matter under the legislation in Queensland. After discussions with the Queensland industry, the QBA, Queensland is comfortable with removing all restrictions for Barula fly and move to Barula fly becoming notifiable in Queensland, so we know what movements there may be of this pest into Queensland and where the issues may be as we continue to monitor where bees are moving. Queensland has agreed to remove the current restrictions and to move to Barula fly becoming notifiable in Queensland, which will be that, you know, we will have industry reporting into us about movements, and we'll be able to keep a check of that pest is moving around in the state, if in fact it does. We're discussing with our in-house legal people whether there are any mechanisms available under the Act to remove these restrictions while the legislation remains in its current form, but it's unlikely that we'll be able to make changes in the very short term to allow those movements to take place. Any lifting of restrictions may have to wait until we can amend the legislation. We've been advised by the QBA of this. Permits for movement would currently apply that would be similar to movement from Tasmania. However, we're still working on getting permitting in place to move live bees and queens into Queensland, but the Barula fly issue will be part of that process, and we'll keep you guys updated as best we can as this process unfolds. Surveillance. So we've been undertaking significant amounts of surveillance for Varroa mites at various locations in Queensland, including tracing information provided by New South Wales on potential movement of risk material into Queensland. We've been monitoring hives returning to Queensland from interstate. We've recently brought some hives back from the pollination events in Victoria and South Australia, and we had strict conditions applied to those movements. And we also have a significant amount of compliance associated with that movement. We continue to monitor sentinel beehives located in Brisbane, Cairns, Townsville, and Mackay seaports. We've also been undertaking significant amount of surveillance in the Cardwell area in response to that suspected Varroa destructor mite that was reported in the Cardwell area. And we've also recently been undertaking surveillance at pollination sites around Bundaberg for avocados and macadamias. And this will continue, and we're currently putting together a plan for our ongoing surveillance into the future as this response continues. We've developed a dashboard to help us communicate how we're going with our surveillance, and you should be able to see that in front of you now. The dashboard was developed to allow us to communicate with the industry, you guys, as well as your peak body, which is the QBA. The information is summarised from the reports we get from our staff in the field, and they're the numbers that we have on the 4th of October. They'll be updated, and we'll provide an updated dashboard to the QBA in the coming days. And I guess this is a really good communication tool. It allows us to present the activity that we've been undertaking out in the field, and it gives the QBA the opportunity to question that and to come back to us and say, well, you know, we think there should be more surveillance, or we're okay with what you're doing now, but we're going to continue to update this dashboard to ensure that the QBA and you as industry members will be able to get the latest information on a weekly basis from the field as we continue to undertake surveillance. That's about all for me. If you've got any questions, let us know. We'll answer what we can today. The rest will take on notice, and we'll provide any responses back through Joe to ensure that you guys are up to date with the latest information we've got. Thanks. Back to you, Dave.
Thanks, Phil. Terrific. So next speaker we have is Rob Smith to update us on applying for a biosecurity instrument and our compliance activities. Thanks, Robert.
Thanks, Dave. Good evening, everyone. And thanks, Phil, for that overview. My team look after the day-to-day activities around the assessment of permits, so we will be the people that you deal with when you you lodge an application through the website, and through that application process and out the other end, and obviously moving from there, as Phil mentioned, there's a compliance element as well. So what I wanted to go through tonight was really just to sort of give you an overview of what that looks like, give you some sort of pointers to where to go, and what we will be looking for throughout the process of the application through providing you with that permit, and then onward as you bring the materials and equipment into Queensland. So I guess we're all very well aware and familiar with the movement control order that first manifested itself in June. The latest version of that was updated on the 6th of June, and that's the most up-to-date version. There hasn't been any change in terms of the controls during that time. It's really just keeping pace with what's happening in other states. So the control order as it stands is made under the Biosecurity Act 2014. It prohibits bees, hives, used equipment and bee-related products from entering Queensland. Obviously, the intention there is to keep Varroa mite out, and that's really what our team has been set up to do. And we work very, very closely with other areas of the department. We're here specifically to manage the control of equipment coming into Queensland. What it doesn't prohibit is processed honey and beeswax, unused brand new apiary appliances, which don't obviously pose a risk, and secured, quarantine secured diagnostic honey samplings, which are destined for testing. One thing I do need to be clear about the control order, the permits that exist under that control order and the restrictions only apply to entry into Queensland. So that's from any state or territory coming into Queensland. So although the movement control order is a fairly robust and prescriptive control mechanism, there is the ability to apply for a permit for a range of different reasons, and you know that permits you under certain conditions to bring in materials, particularly at the moment, then moving forward onto live bees as well. So those permits are statutory instruments. They are they have a range of conditions attached with them, and those conditions are designed to make sure that at departure through travel and on arrival in Queensland, there is little risk or no risk, I guess, is the overall objective of the of bees escaping from that load, or bees from within Queensland coming into contact with those that have been outside. Just to reiterate, we are here to prevent Varroa coming in, and obviously we're doing that with a very close partnership with industry, and certainly are very conscious of the impact that that's having, and we are working very hard on a day-to-day basis to minimise the impact on industry that these restrictions bring to bear. So there are a range of different permit types, some of which are available and some of which are not. At the moment, we are processing and granting permits for hive and hive parts, supers and the like, that are coming in for extraction, empty hive and hive parts, which are free of product, and materials, parts of hives that are coming in into Queensland for irradiation at our southeast Queensland facility. Also, most recently, as Phil mentioned earlier, the risk assessment and the conditions have now been approved to allow used bee-related equipment in as well. There are a couple of others which will come in time, and you know, that's Queens. Queens is a priority for us at the moment. We're looking, there's a lot of work, there's an entire team looking at how that can happen safely. So I guess that will probably be the next cab off the rank. And then in time, another work in progress is obviously live bees. There is a big jump between equipment and live bees, as you will understand. So it's very important that we not only get that risk management in place and get the right permits in place, but we do that in partnership with industry and also our partners in other states and territories. So the national approach is a very important one. So as you can imagine, there are a number of people around that table. But for now, unfortunately, we can't make those in, but we are hoping that in the not too distant future, the situation will change and we'll be able to provide permits for those two remaining pieces of work that are in progress. So how do you apply? You apply online. Maybe I'll just get you to flash up the permit. No, don't do that. Just click the link to the next slide and it should come up. There we go. If by magic, a permit application appears. So that's what it looks like. That's available online through the link that will appear equally by magic in the chat later on. So what that does is that really just asks you for your basic information. Thanks, Dave. From there, once we've received that will come through to one of our permitting officers and they'll call you back and have a discussion around what you're actually seeking to achieve and the measures that are likely to be necessary for you to be able to get that permit and also what the process is. We are at the moment able to provide one officer for each application. So we are wherever possible seeking to have you having applicants dealing with the same person so that they understand the specific situation and can put together a permit which both creates the required level of risk control but also meets your needs. It is a very sort of one-on-one process, but we have our permitting officers and biosecurity officers there to help you through that. At the moment, we're looking at a 3 to 5 day processing period. 3 days if it's simple. If there is a high level of risk and it's a more complex assessment, then that may take a little more. Also, we may need to seek a little bit more information from you, or even in some cases, potentially come down and do an inspection with you on site so we can completely understand what your operation looks like so we can tailor that permit appropriately. Excellent, thanks, Dave. So I guess the all important question is, what do you need to do? So you follow through that the application process online. Let the permitting officer know exactly what you're looking for. He'll then work through the process that you need to follow and the measures you need to take. Typically, before entering Queensland, you must apply and obtain a permit. If you want to bring in any of those materials that I mentioned earlier. But before entering in Queensland, you need to understand what the permit requires you to do and meet all of those conditions. There are quite a lot, so I won't go through each and every one tonight, but effectively, we're looking for what is pretty much the more obvious the more obvious measures to make sure that the bees can't escape or come into contact with any others along the way. So that looks like undertaking a pre-departure inspection to make sure that you are complying with all the conditions on your permit. Fundamentally that is that the load is 100% bee proof. Others can't get in and they can't get out to eliminate the risk of transmitting anything that they, particularly Varroa mite, that they might be carrying. Transport directly to the destination that you've nominated on the permit. We would prefer you not to stop if that's possible, but obviously we're aware of the fact that there are fatigue issues to take into consideration and also toilet breaks and the like. So that's not a sort of hard and fast situation, but we would like you to keep a record of the journey, not because we need to spend time reviewing each and every toilet break, but if there is an outbreak, then it gives us a good idea of what we've got traveling through what areas, and potentially gives us an avenue to try and locate where that potential incursions come from. So we one of the permits that we provide is treatment, an approved facility. So that again is 100% beef roof in directly into the facility, then handed over to the facility. The permit process is the same. And of course, after arrival in Queensland, then all of the permits have a quarantine requirement to make sure that the load is kept for a period of time and potentially a temperature or a specific place, which is necessary to absolutely make sure that there are no Varroa mites residing on what you've brought in. Obviously, there's a lot of work going into to providing the ability for operators to bring that equipment in, and part of our role is also keeping you honest. So we are checking compliance. We've been doing that now for a week or so. Most of our compliance work up until now has been focused on arrival into Queensland, but also some follow-up visits for some that have arrived a week or so ago. So those really at the moment are just making sure that compliance with the permit conditions is ongoing, and just discussing the issues, any issues that we find with the permit holder at the time. We do take suspected breaches, suspected incursions very, very seriously, obviously, and we work closely with our colleagues across the department to respond to those immediately, to nip anything that may be a problem in the bud straight away. Our priority for compliance at this point in time is potential breaches, as I said, and being able to provide a timely turnaround on those permits, and also making sure that they are being complied with. There are large fines for non-compliance. The maximum fine under the Biosecurity Act for bringing in prohibited matter is some $286,000. So it's a fairly significant incentive to work with us to help you, the industry, and keep Queensland clear of Varroa mite. I do believe that's pretty much all I had on that particular subject, Dave. Thanks very much. Back to you.
Thanks, Rob. I'm going to now talk a little bit about, after Mia will throw to Joe, about the B123 survey form, as well as some of the testing that we're recording. With the B123 survey form, as Phil mentioned earlier, we are requesting all beekeepers to check their hives and to report those results, because those results, that data that we're trying to collect is going to demonstrate to all the other states and territories that we are free of Varroa mite, and that has implications on free movement of equipment and bees between states. So we really require that. Just as a bit of an introduction to that, just a reminder to everybody that under the Biosecurity Act, everybody in the state has a general biosecurity obligation. And part of that obligation, especially for beekeepers, is registering, making sure that you're a registered biosecurity entity, so a registered beekeeper, and that you have a hive identification number and that you mark your hives with that hive identification number. And with that hive identification number that can then be used to report your data as well. And to check your hives for pests and diseases regularly is a must, especially now that we know that there was that large Varroa incursion in New South Wales, which really should be checking them quite regularly to make sure that the eradication program has worked. So we'll be asking people to keep checking for mites probably well into the future, and to report any notifiable pests or diseases. So that's any mites or anything that you might find that's in your hives, and including American foul brood and notifiable pests and diseases such as that, and practicing good bee biosecurity. All of these are outlined in the Biosecurity Code of Practice. And so if you haven't got a copy, get a copy. They're freely downloadable from the Be Aware website. Looking at what we're looking for, we're not just looking for varroa mites. So before varroa mites showed up, we were also looking for other things. So Barula fly has been detected on the mainland, so we're looking for that as well. But we're also looking for any possible new incursions of varroa mite, and we're also looking for any possible incursions of tropolalapse mites, which could come in, and they sometimes may be able to come in on things like Asian honeybee swarms if there's new incursions of those. So which is why Asian honeybee, even though they are established in North Queensland, are still notifiable, because we still have to check them to make sure that they aren't new incursions, and they may still carry, you know, if there's a new incursion, they may bring in new sources of mites. So with that, there's three ways to check for these. So these methods should be able to detect all of these external parasites. So there's alcohol wash, which is our recommended method. It's our standard method, and that all states are using. And we ask for drone uncapping and potentially sugar shake. Under some circumstances, sugar shake might be more appropriate. If you are uncomfortable with doing an alcohol wash, then we'd say sugar shake, but alcohol wash is our recommended method. All of these methods are available on our website. I'll show you how to reach them later on. But if you just go to the DAF website and type in hive check varroa, it should take you, it should be the first link. It should take you directly to where you can find these. So just as a brief overview of alcohol washing, As I said, it is our recommended method. It is used by all states, and it's our major what we are recommending people to do. And as I said, the instructions are on our eHub, on our engagement hub. The link is there, but we'll provide links to our engagement hub in the chat. So drone uncapping. What we're also asking people to do is when you do an alcohol wash or a sugar shake, but preferably an alcohol wash, that you also check capped brood for mites. So most of the mites will be in capped brood, preferably drone brood, and this is the season that you'll get a lot more drone brood. So when drone brood is available, check that. Again, the instructions are on our eHub, but we're combining those with the alcohol wash, because the alcohol wash will detect mites that are on adult bees, but the drone brood will be able to detect mites that are within cap brood, so that you won't be able to detect with the alcohol wash. So those two combined make for a much more sensitive check. And it's also quite rapid, and you only need a little bit of equipment. You only need a comb scratcher to do a drone brood uncapping. Sugar shaking, it is quick and easy. It doesn't kill the bees, but it is a lot less sensitive method, which is why it is not our recommendation. So when we do our hives, when we do our surveillance activities and we have our permitting conditions, you really should be doing, we are just stipulating that we do an alcohol wash. The sugar shake is only really for people who are quite uncomfortable with doing an alcohol wash, or you feel like you're not experienced enough to be able to find the queen, because you can't put the queen in an alcohol wash. And under some circumstances, such as perhaps movement of queen bees, we might ask for a sugar shake. So going on to the Bee123 online survey form. So once you do your alcohol wash and your drone uncapping, we are asking you to report your results. So that data will go into helping us demonstrate our area of freedom and to be able to allow freer movement of bees and equipment between states. And if you have any questions at all, or you don't know what to do next, you can always call the DAF call centre on 13 25 23 right, for more information. So we have our QR code here. I'll show you how to reach it on our when I do the demonstration on our website. And you can download the Survey 123 app, and then you select the QR code. You can scan the QR code, and so you can complete the form either online, or you can complete it on a mobile phone, on a mobile device. And if you can't access it for whatever reason, but you've done your tests, but you can't, you feel like you can't report online, you can always call our call centre on 13 25 23 and provide them your details and the results of your test, and they can submit the results for you. So they will still be counted, right? It's just a phone call away. Just to give you an idea of where we're at so far, so this is the latest data that we have. You might not see this very well, but we have a fair spread of tests across the state, mostly localised in towards the southeast corner, but we do have them all the way up to past Cairns. We've got 336 surveys completed. However, the number of hives checked is nearly 3,000, but that's only 2% of the total number of hives that are really in the state, and we need to get that number up. I still have to find out exactly where we want to, but we need to at least pass 5% and preferably up past 10% if we can. So the more hives tested, the better confidence that we have, and we can demonstrate that Varroa isn't here. And as I said, we're also checking for any other incursions that we may not have previously detected. So, but if you look at the number of beekeepers reporting, we've had a reasonable effort, and the number of commercial beekeepers is now up to 5%. It's just gone past 5% of beekeepers actually reporting their results. But the non-commercial beekeepers, the recreational beekeepers, is still just under 2%. So we really need to try and get that number up. So just to give you a demonstration on how to get to the form and what it looks like. When you go to our engagement hub, it looks like this. And then you scroll down the page and we have all the latest information for moving bees into Queensland and links to the permitting, etc. And the latest news. And we have our three ways to check for your Varroa, check your hives for Varroa mite. So that has links to the fact sheets on how to perform the tests. And we also have, just above that, we have our report your results. So if I click that, that will take us to this page, and it gives you step-by-step instructions on how to report. And at the top here, it says use our Bee123 online form. So if you're going to our, if you're reporting online, it will take you to our live link, and it says complete this form to report any checks. So you can either scan that or open in browser, so you can open in a survey app, or you can open it in your browser. So if you're connecting on your phone, you can take it to an app, or to the survey app, or you can just fill it out on your browser. When we go here, it has the date you checked your hive. So if I could fill out today, just check my hive today, what type of beekeeper you are, whether you're recreational, commercial, or unregistered, what your hive identification number is. So I can put in an example hive identification number, but you should be putting in your hive identification number. What's the purpose of your surveillance? So it asks you several questions. So it's either hive health check, you can report on feral honeybees. So if you've collected a swarm and checked a swarm, right, and that's very helpful. Any hives leaving Queensland, so this is for permitting, etc., or hives entering Queensland, right? So you can report the results of your test through this form. So most of us would be clicking hive health check. So it's just what you've just regularly checked, just your hives within Queensland. Click next, and then we can have a site location. So you can drop a pin on a map, right? Or you can find your address just by typing in your address and find your address and use that, and it'll drop the pin on the map. And so that gives us our GPS coordinates. And you have just we're not keeping track of where you're keeping your bees or anything, but we just need that location, like that approximate location, so that we know that we have a good spread of results and data from around the state. And it asks you if you're reporting the results of an Asian honeybee colony. So this is especially important for people in North Queensland. From a known infested area. It asks you how many hives you might have at the site. So a recreational beekeeper might have five hives, and how many hives did I check? Say I checked four hives, right? And it asks you what the method of examining hives. So you can click more than one. So say I did an alcohol wash and a drone uncapping. So that would be the preferable two tests that we would ask you to do. And then did you find any type of mite? So that is, if any suspect, if you have anything suspect, you don't have to identify it as a mite, but if you have a suspect, then you would click yes, right? And so then it gives you a little instruction. So if you find anything suspect while doing your test, then we're asking you to take a photograph of it, right? So that we can take a quick look and then say, well, do we need to send somebody out immediately to have a look at it? How are we going to collect that sample and all of that? You know, so you want to save that sample so that we can collect it and confirm whether it was a mite or not. We have had a couple of suspect click yeses and been able to double check and rule out those mites. So to date, we have zero confirmed reports of mites, even though we've had more than one suspect reports of mites. And it'll ask you to drop your image here, so you can drop your image in and we can have a look at it, right? And save your sample, right? And those instructions are again on our website. So I'll just click no for the moment and hit next. And then it'll ask you for your contact details so that we can get in contact with you. Just your first name, last name, address, phone number, email, so that we can get in contact with you about anything that you've reported. And then submit, and that's it. And then that will submit your hive check. So it's pretty easy. It's only three pages, with a bit of information about where you are, who you are, and what you checked for and what you found. That's it. So I will hand on to Joe to talk about the importance of reporting for industry. Thanks, Joe.
Thanks, Dave. And on behalf of industry, I'd just like to thank the team from Biosecurity Queensland. Certainly the QBA have been working in a collaborative effort with the department and identifying practical solutions with regards to the current response efforts that we find ourselves in. It really is the priority of the QBA to maintain Queensland as Varroa free at this point in time. A Varroa outbreak would be catastrophic for the industry. Let us be clear. It would have devastating impacts on our commercial beekeeping industry. Our recreational sector would also definitely feel the consequences, and our farming friends as well, who rely on our honeybees being trucked into farms for very short periods of time to really provide that pollination service out to our fruit and veggie crops that, you know, we've all become so accustomed to understanding that they're so freely available. So, you know, industry is really calling on all of our members within our industry, whether you're a member of the Queensland Beekeepers, whether you're a member of a local club, or you're a recreational beekeeper out there across Queensland. There is 9,000 strong beekeepers in the state, and we need every beekeeper in the state stepping up to the plate right now and taking action today. Every day that the sun's shining in the sky is a great day to go and get into your hives, break open into the brood box, and start to conduct your Varroa mite surveillance. You know, moving forward, that the response setting that we find ourselves in, the industry must have the confidence that we're free of Varroa. With the statistics that we have on file at the moment and the data that we've received through the reports in the Bee123 app, it is somewhat of a very small glimpse, I suppose, into a much broader picture. So what we really need to do is all beekeepers this weekend, if there's a clear weather pattern, I know that we're dealing with some rather extreme wet weather events, but please get yourselves into your boxes. Start doing those tests. If you're running a large apiary, test 10% of your hives. Record the data and then simply put it into the Bee123 app. If you're not comfortable with doing that, as the team have said, 13 25 23 is the only number that you need to remember, and the team at the service desk can definitely help and support you with making the industry more aware of our level of freedom from Varroa at the moment. I suppose something else to probably add into that context as well is that in order for industry as a whole across the eastern seaboard to start moving ahead, and we see some type of movement with regards to beehives transversing state borders, other states have to have the confidence that states that are currently declaring that they're free of Varroa mite can actually prove that data. So in order for us to have that information, we need to be flooding the map of Queensland with all of those blue dots that Dave showed us before. So please, again, I reiterate, get out there and check your hives. It's a matter of priority for every beekeeper in the state. Industry surveillance from the recreation and commercial beekeeping sector, it has been challenging, I will admit it, but definitely the QBA's position is at an absolute minimum. The alcohol wash and the drone uncapping is the two key elements that you need to be doing. If you're not confident with completing these tests, ask for help. There's a lot of beekeeping clubs and communities that are across the state, and there are so many people out there that will be willing to help you with that. May I also add as well that, you know, should this situation, we are confident of containment and we are absolutely on par for, you know, doing everything that we can to eliminate and eradicate Varroa out of Australia. What we ultimately need to be doing as well is making sure that these tests, something as simple as an alcohol wash, will become a core responsibility should Varroa ever be declared endemic. So, you know, that will become a part of our integrated pest management system and how we monitor for mite levels and mite infestations in our hive. So it's a really important tool in every beekeeper's toolbox to start doing those checks now. Become confident with doing that now so that in the future, if something did happen, you've got the right skill set to be able to support your hives and to breed strong, healthy bee colonies. Most importantly, we're really calling on everyone to be a part of the team. If you're not a beekeeper, I know that there's a lot of interested people in the community that dial into these webinars because they're passionate about our honeybees. You know, make sure that if you're buying that local bucket of honey from a local beekeeper, play your part as being a responsible person and ensuring your own general biosecurity obligation. Ask that beekeeper, are you registered with the system? Are you a registered beekeeper? Have you been getting any communication? What's going on with the Varroa mite at the moment? Certainly to wrap up, you know, QBA is something, an organisation that we are here as our core responsibility to protect the welfare and interests of the beekeeping industry in Queensland and all of those industries and farming friends that are so dependent on our bees being trucked from forests into farm and providing that key pollination service and, you know, producing world-class honey. So, you know, please, where possible, support the industry body that is going the long yards to protect the welfare of every beekeeper in this state. And again, we'd just like to sing the praises and thank the team at Biosecurity Queensland for their continued effort. From industry's perspective, it has been a very, very long ride to get here. 14 weeks, I beg my pardon, possibly 15 since the date of incursion. So it has been a very anxious time for everyone on board. But the weather's warming up. The only thing I can say is get in your boxes today. Don't waste time. Keep calm and carry on, but check for Varroa. Thanks, Dave.
Thanks, Joe. So that's the end of our speaker presentations. I think we have our live Q&A. So if anyone has any questions that they would like to ask, we are opening up the questions, I think. We should be, so far no questions.
No questions at the moment, Dave.
Okay. I should have put one in. It's very important that we do keep like that. Everybody, actually, every beekeeper does learn how to conduct one of these tests, as you say, Joe. Like, it's one of those things that that I kind of didn't realize, but it's actually going to be ongoing into the future. You know, a lot of people have kind of been a bit relaxed in the past, but it's not just demonstrating that freedom. Like, if it does get established, heaven forbid. But if it does, then it will be an ongoing tool. So, I mean, you might as well learn how to do it now. So, and do it regularly, and do it. Yeah, do it often.
I would absolutely agree. It's completing the surveillance for any type of pest and disease is as important as being able to light your bee smoker. They are key checks. Definitely something at the moment all beekeepers should be considering is, even though we find ourselves in the midst of a response to an incursion, it's very, very important that beekeepers are going out and doing their fundamental checks that you should be doing at this time of the year. So, we really do recommend that beekeepers are checking in on their brood, at least conducting a hive inspection every 7 to 10 days at the moment, and being very mindful that the bees are on the move. This is the time that the colonies begin to wake up. There is an available, an abundant supply in a lot of areas of nectar and pollen, and quite often what it can be is that the bees are simply moving out of space within their current home. So, we're definitely getting some reports of swarming. I know the department's dealing with some of those phone calls of swarming. So it's important that every beekeeper's going out there and making sure that they've not only got provisions for the bees to be, providing area to store their honey up and to store their pollen, but for room for growth in their colonies. And, something as simple as some frame replacement, for example, adding some new comb in foundation, for example, to allow the bees space and time to work on another alternative instead of that core, honey production effectively. But there's a lot of key steps. The QBA is working together to put out some helpful advice out there, a couple of tips that might support those beekeepers new to our area, because we're certainly well aware that there's been an increase in population of beekeepers in the last few years, probably attributed to people being at home and wanting to spend more time in your backyard. So it's probably a timely check-in that if you haven't looked in your beehive already this year, really you should be finding that first opportunity that you get. Varroa mite surveillance number one, but also making sure you're playing your part in your general biosecurity obligation by minimizing the risk of those bees swarming. And if you've got any questions or you're new to this industry, please reach out for help. The department's there definitely to support that, but your local clubs are just a wealth of knowledge, Dave. You're fortunate enough to travel the state and see a lot of our clubs, I suppose. Getting those boxes, this brilliant weather when it's not raining at the moment, to get out there and start doing what you need to. I think we've got some questions in there now, Dave.
Yeah, so we also have a comment from Steve. Thanks, Steve. That the online Bee123 is very simple and easy to use, and I would agree. I think they've tried to make it as easy as possible and to collect the necessary data. The developers for that did a very good job. We have a question from Anonymous. Is there a video which shows the process of doing the alcohol wash? There is a video on the Plant Health Australia website by Tug Somerville, but he only alcohol washes for about 20 seconds. So we haven't linked it on our website because it doesn't meet our requirements, but we are in the process of doing another video to show you the alcohol wash. That one gives you the impression, but the actual instructions are on our website. So we were recommending up to about 4 minutes of shaking, whereas the old video, because it was over 10 years ago, only has about 20 seconds of shaking. So just be aware of that. But you can find those videos on, either on YouTube or on the Plant Health Australia website. But remember, for Queensland, we are asking people to do it for about 4 minutes. So what is processed honey and beeswax? Is there a definition of that, Rob? Maybe I'll throw that one to you for your processed honey and beeswax.
Thanks, Dave. Yeah, I mean, there are obviously a variety of processes in the industry, and without going through every one, generally speaking, they're subject to, the product is subject to heat treatment for a prescribed period of time, depending on the product. So that will eradicate any contamination from microorganisms or any biological contamination from insects and the like. It is standard practice, as I understand it, in the industry anyway. So purification and treatment process is really what that alludes to. But it will depend very much on the volume and the type of product. But effectively, it's the treatment that has been undertaken to make sure that it's free from living things.
Okay, thanks, Rob. I think there's another question that probably you'd be able to answer. And that's in your talk, you mentioned for moving into Queensland that a pre-departure inspection, is required. And people are someone's asking, how does one arrange that? Do you arrange a pre-departure inspection?
Yeah, thanks, Dave. We won't routinely ask for that. We would, as part of the permit conditions, then we will ask for the applicant to do an inspection, and just record the fact that they've done an inspection. There may be situations or times when we do, and we'll arrange for a pre-departure inspection to be undertaken by one of our officers with the permit holder. But we won't be doing a complete inspection for everyone that leaves its source location. I guess the recording part of that, the documentation requirements and the permit are where that kicks in. A lot of the reason around that is we would assume that the risk would be reasonably low, given that we've been working with that person for some time through the process of applying for and obtaining the permit. We're generally pretty comfortable that they understand what their obligations are, and we'll be able to undertake that inspection to make sure that they comply with the conditions themselves. If you want an inspection done for whatever reason, then the first port of call I would suggest would be to contact the officer who issued your permit, and they'll be able to either talk you through the process of what to look for, potentially arrange a time to come down and do that inspection.
Yeah, thanks, Rob. Okay, so next one down the list. So Melissa's asking, if I do a sugar shake or alcohol wash on my hives and no mites are found, how confident can I be that my hives are free of varroa? That's actually a really good question, and not so easy to answer, because when you do an alcohol wash or a sugar shake, you're only taking a sample of the hive. You're not testing the whole hive at once. So you're only be fairly confident with an alcohol wash. I think it's somewhere between over 80%, we're about 85 to 90% confident that you've detected any mites in that specific sample, or higher. So the longer you shake it, this is why we say 4 minutes, the more confident you are that you're shaking the mites off there. The sugar shake is less sensitive. So some reports saying it's about, you're about 65% confident that you've detected the mite that's in that sample. So, but the most important thing is that you do it fairly regularly. and you do it fairly often. So the more often you do it, the more likely you are to detect something. So if you have low levels of infestation in a hive, there are very few methods that will actually be able to detect it, because the numbers are so low and it's very difficult to check the whole hive at the same time and be able to collect the mites from that. But if you're checking it over time, so you could be more and more confident. So if you have mites in there and they start developing, breeding up into larger numbers, then you will be able to detect it when it passes that threshold that you can detect it. So the most important thing is to really, doesn't matter really what method you use, preferably alcohol wash because it's more sensitive, you'll detect it earlier, right? But do it regularly and do it fairly often. Like, so whenever you're doing a hive check, you should be doing an alcohol wash so that you can detect those mites when they build up, if they build up, if they're there.
I might just quickly, sorry, Dave, I might jump in there as well. It's probably a better practice to make sure that you're performing an alcohol wash around about sort of at 12 to 16 week intervals. So you're going to have a better success rate, I suppose, in regularly conducting those tests. But just being very, very well aware that if you're oversampling your bees and your hive, there can be some consequences involved in that. So make sure that, you know, if you're conducting an alcohol wash maybe this weekend, it might be timely to jump in and conduct another one in and around maybe about Christmas time or the week before Christmas and report those results again. It's really important that everyone's reporting the results of their activity, irregardless whether it's negative data or you believe that you've found something. Obviously, if you believe that you've found something, jump on that phone straight away, because we want to have teams there as soon as physically possible, even if it is suspect and you're just not sure. So, definitely the consistency in the application for checking, definitely within New South Wales, it's every 16 weeks at the moment. So somewhere between that 12 and 16 weeks is probably a good interval for doing those alcohol washes.
Thank you, Joe. Okay, so we'll move on to the next question. So we have a question: are there more accurate methods for detecting Varroa than alcohol washes? I'll field that one. Yes, because the more accurate test requires a larger sample. So the tests that you can check more bees at one time tend to be more accurate. So that depends on the sample size. So there are tests where you can where we can deploy in hive surveillance activities, where we have miticides and sticky mats that are more accurate, but they do require chemical permits to use, and they require some expertise to deploy, and they're fairly expensive as well. So this is why we're asking everybody to do alcohol washes, is that everybody should be able to have access to an alcohol wash jar, or be able to make one of your own, methylated spirits, so clear methylated spirits will work in those washes, whereas the miticide strips are a bit more difficult to obtain. So even though, and they also can leave chemical residues within a hive, so this is why we're keeping them for hive surveillance activities. But the best accurate test is the one that you actually do. So if you're not going to do a test, then you're not going to know anything. We do try and get the sensitivity up, but the more often you do even a low sensitive test, the more likely you are to detect something if it's there. So that's why we're asking people to do alcohol washes. Everybody should have access to that. So I think that's, unless you have anyone else, Joe, you have anything that, okay, terrific. Okay, we'll move on. So why has it taken so long for Queensland bees stuck in New South Wales to be able to come home? I think this is one for Phil, because Philip's a head of our Varroa response team. Philip, could you answer that one?
Yeah, sure. I mean, I guess we've been on board, as in our small team working in DAF at the moment, we're on board for about 4 or 5 weeks. We were given a list of priorities for movement to ensure that the different bits and pieces could move into Queensland. And we worked with the QBA on the highest priorities, which were initially supers and then other material to come into Queensland for irradiation. And then we've moved on to PPE and other components associated with hives, etc. The other two high priority issues are movement of queen bees and then movement of live bees and the associated material into Queensland. Obviously, movement of live bees, including queens and others associated with hives, have the highest risk. So we've got the permitting in place in a fairly short period of time, a few weeks. That's now active, as we've been talking about. We are hoping to have the movement of queen bees. I can't give a time frame, but you know, very soon. And then the movement of bees is being negotiated at the national level. So what we want to make sure is that we have consistency between the states on movement of live bees and hives from South Australia, Victoria, New South Wales and Queensland, so that we want to get it in place once and for all, so that it's simple to understand and we don't have any complexities associated with movement, so that if we have a pollination event or whatever we might have, we have consistency and it's simple for beekeepers to understand. Now, we're getting closer to having that permitting available, but we are still some time away. But as I say, it's being negotiated at the national level between jurisdictions, so between states. So as hard as we are pushing, and we are pushing for the other states to come on board with the united front, it does take time to get agreement between jurisdictions. Each jurisdiction has its own rules and regulations for its own purposes, so it does take time to get agreement, but we want to make sure that we've got agreement at the national level once and for all, so once we're in place we can move forward together and make it as simple as possible for beekeepers. Thanks.
Okay, I've been told that, thanks Phil, quite comprehensive. Yeah, I've been told that we're actually well over time, and we have quite a number of questions. So we're going to try and put together a frequently like a FAQ of the questions that we have tonight, and put it on our eHub. So there's a number of questions about checking, who's checking things at the borders and how many surveillance officers that we have doing activities and all that. And the answers to those questions might take a little bit of time. So we'll be taking those questions and we'll try and put them on our engagement hub. I don't think we have enough time to actually answer it now. We have to wrap up. Sorry about that. Just to reiterate, we do have permits for moving supers into Queensland and for irradiation and all that sort of thing. It's only the live bees that we're having currently still working on risk assessments and things like that for, like to try and manage those risks of live bee movements.
Just on that, yeah, if possible. I saw there's a question a little bit further down about bringing back supers for extraction and then taking the stickies back to New South Wales. Excellent response that you just gave, I could just add that yes, a permit is available for that. Obviously they need to be transported in a bee safe way, come into Queensland. If they stay in Queensland, then the quarantine arrangements under the permit will apply. If they're being returned to New South Wales, then New South Wales requirements will need to be met as they go south over the border.
Okay, yeah, thanks, Rob. So yes, with that, I mean, we are well over time and there are a lot of very good questions, in fact. So we will be putting those up on our eHub, which links are in the chat as well. So I do have to wrap it up, and I'd like to thank our production team, that's Larissa and Cam, as well as our speakers, Philip, Rob, Joe. Thank you for attending tonight and providing all that information, and everybody who's involved in response and preparedness in the state. We're all very busy at the moment, trying to get around and increase our confidence that the eradication program is working, and that we are still free of Varroa in Queensland. So yeah, we'll try with a follow up. Listing of links and details raised here. Thank you for coming, everybody. We'll say good night.
Have a good evening.
Wrap it there. Leave it there.
Thanks everybody.
Thanks, everyone.